I don't feel I have anything else to add, so why? Thank you so much.
Oh, but I desperately want you to disagree.
No, I think that you should follow me and read these words aloud as I make my way to different cities. This would be very helpful for my...
Is there good money in that record?
Well, we'll have to see. It's all negotiable.
So, you have been talking about this book a lot, past year, I guess?
I guess the past year or so. You know, it's done... There's been much more interest in the book in other countries than in America, where it grew slowly. And I was just saying to my publishers here that, for whatever this says about you guys, that the countries it's done best in have been Australia and the Netherlands. So, make of that what you will. No one has a good explanation.
Trying to make something of it.
Well, the Australians are very flinty. You know, they're very self-possessed, which I always thought the Dutch were as well, but apparently you're all a bunch of selfies. Is the lesson that I've taken. But I'm very, very grateful, and I'm thrilled to be here, and so grateful to Auke, who was one of the first to read it, and to everyone here. It's a great honor, and it's an unmatchable sense of communion when you have a reader read anything that you've written. And the fact that so many people have done so seriously and wholeheartedly has been a never-ending source of surprise. So thank you to all of you. Closer. Oh, better. Okay. They didn't hear the thanks thing.
Is talking about a little life different than talking about your other book, your first book, your debut?
Well, no one read the first one. I mean, no, it's true. No one read it. The Dutch read it. Oh, some people in the audience read it. Oh, that's so nice. About 12 people read it. The Dutch were the only ones who were stupid enough to buy rights.
But now it turns out to be pretty smart, huh?
Now it turns out to be smart, but they took a gamble. And they're two very different books, and so I think that the reader of the second book, I probably shouldn't say this, won't necessarily like the first one.
But would you say that this one is dearer to your heart?
You know, I agree with what you said about not needing to like your characters. You need to love them, and I did with the character in the first book, the protagonist in the first book, who is in many ways deeply repellent. But this book was a book that had so much that I wanted to say and hadn't known I wanted to say about friendship and about love and about trauma. And so while the book itself was difficult to write in passages because it was so emotionally demanding, it was also a world I loved being in. I loved being with these characters. I loved spending time with them. And I hope that the reader feels that I did love them, that there's a sense of intimacy that I hope is conveyed in the pages, that I knew this world, and I knew these characters, I knew things about them that don't appear on the page, and I loved spending time with them. And I think that you can always sense, or I feel I can always sense, when an author loves being in her world, and that's not always the case, and nor should it always be the case, but it was definitely the case with this book, in a way that I don't think I'll be able to replicate, and I think it was just luck.
Mm-hmm. Maybe for the three people I counted that didn't read it, we might want to give them like a taste of what the book is. If you could read.
Oh, this is my cue to read. Okay.
I
was told.
Well, we were having a conversation.
We were going to.
More full disclosure.
Yes, we were going to rebel and not read at all.
No, you are going to read. Our rebellion consisted of.
We're shortening.
Right. We both hate reading.
Yeah, we both don't like it. But I was told that Europeans like to hear reading, so I'm going to read. Should I read? I'm going to read. Is this working? All right, so this is the section, those of you who have read it will recognize this passage, I hope. And Jude, the main character, has a disastrous first relationship as an adult. And this is the section directly after something horrible happens, which I could really say I haven't applied in many sections of the book. There were two ways of forgetting. For many years, he had envisioned, unimaginatively, a vault. And at the end of the day, he would gather the images and sequences and words that he didn't want to think about again, and open the heavy steel door only enough to hurry them inside, closing it quickly and tightly. But this method wasn't effective. The memory seeped out anyway. The important thing, he came to realize, was to eliminate them, not just to store them. So he had invented some solutions for small memories, little slights, insults. You relive them again and again until they were neutralized, until they became near meaningless with repetition, or until you could believe that they were something that had happened to someone else and you had just heard about it. For larger memories, you held the scene in your head like a film strip, and then you began to erase it, frame by frame. Neither method was easy. You couldn't stop in the middle of your erasing and examine what you were looking at, for example. You couldn't start scrolling through parts of it and hope you wouldn't get ensnared in the details of what had happened, because you of course would. You had to work at it every night until it was completely gone. Though they never disappear completely, of course, but they were at least more distant. They weren't things that followed you, wraith-like, tugging at you for attention, jumping in front of you when you ignored them, demanding so much of your time and effort that it became impossible to think of anything else. In fallow periods, the moments before you fell asleep, the minutes before you were landing after an overnight flight, when you weren't awake enough to do work and weren't tired enough to sleep, they would reassert themselves. And so it was best to imagine then a screen of white, huge and light lit and still, and hold it in your mind like a shield. In the weeks following the beating, he worked on forgetting Caleb. Before going to bed, he went to the door of his apartment and, feeling foolish, tried forcing his old set of keys into the locks to assure himself that they didn't fit, that he really was once again safe. He set and reset the alarm system he had installed, which is so sensitive that even passing shadows triggered a flurry of beeps. And then he lay awake, his eyes open in the dark room, concentrating on forgetting. But it was so difficult. There are so many memories from those months that stabbed him that he was overwhelmed. He heard Caleb's voice saying things to him. He saw the expression of Caleb's face as he stared at his body. He felt the horrid blank airlessness of his fall down the staircase. And he crunched himself into a knot and put his hands over his ears and closed his eyes. Finally, he would get up and go to his office at the other end of the apartment to work. He had a big case coming up, and he was grateful for it. His days were so occupied that he had little time to think of anything else. For a while, he was hardly going home at all, just 2 hours to sleep and an hour to shower and change. Until one evening, he had an episode at work, a bad one, the first time he ever had. The night janitor found him on the floor and had called the building security department, who had called the firm's chairman, who had called Lucian, who was the only one he had told what to do in case something like this should happen. Lucian had called Andy, and then both he and the chairman had come into the office and waited with him for Andy to arrive. He had seen them, seen their feet, and even as he had gasped and writhed on the ground, he had tried to find the energy to beg them to leave, to reassure them that he was fine, that he just needed to be left alone. But they hadn't left, and Lucian had sat on the floor near his head and held his hand, and he had been so embarrassed he had almost cried. Later, he had told them again and again that it was nothing, that this happened all the time. But they had made him take the rest of the week off, and the following Monday, Lucian had told him that they were making him go home at a reasonable hour, midnight on the weekdays, 9 p.m. on the weekends. Thank you.
So why is reading hard?
Sorry?
Why is reading hard?
Well, I mean, it's unnatural. I mean, I think it's something that you associate with doing for something, someone you love, or for a child. And so it's such an intimate sort of expression of voice. And to do it in front of a room of very nice strangers. It feels like you're kind of doing a striptease.
But in a way, that's what writing is, because you're talking to a very, very big room full of people.
It's, well, but I think there's, I mean, you're a writer too, and there's a difference between writing, which is a private act and an interior act, and being an author, which is a performative act. And, you know, these days, you have to be comfortable with both, because it's the only opportunity you have to meet the people who have actually read your work. But it is, reading itself is such an intimate experience that there's something that, when I go to hear writers speak, there's always this charge, because you feel that you are seeing someone with whom you had a very private relationship, perhaps one that you couldn't explain, and suddenly there they are, and it's sort of disappointing to see them, and they're opening their mouths, or they're wearing funny clothes, and it breaks the sort of communion between the reader and the writer in a strange way, I think.
When you're writing, are you aware of the fact that you're, although it's a very intimate act, potentially are speaking to a lot of people?
No, I mean, I think that there are some writers who do write and they'll say, I think of the audience, I think of who the reader might be, and I never do. And after a while, you know, I wrote this book very much for my best friend who informed so much of what it has to say.
Jared,
yes, about love and relationships. But after a certain point, I think, in the writing, for me at least, your only real fealty, your only real loyalty is to the life of the book itself. You even stop thinking about that reader. And there is a moment of possession in the act of writing, and you hope for this at least, where up until a certain point you feel that you're the creator of this world and you're making it. And then at some point, and you're never able to quite realize when, you realize that you're a vehicle for this world to express itself. And your job is to sit there and type as fast as you can, and to get down the words as fast as you can and as truly as you can. And then that's when you really realize after the fact that that's the only thing you're trying to do. You're trying to make these character stories shimmer, and you're trying to make the world as big and as realized as you can. And you're never able to pinpoint when that moment happens.
Can you pinpoint where the genesis of this book lies? What triggered it?
It had a few different genesis, I guess. The first was, and I've spoken about this before, so apologies if any of you have heard this, but was I wanted to write a character who never got better. And I thought, what would be, we're so used to, not just in novels, but in most fictional works, in a character beginning at one point and ending in another. And I thought, what if you had a character who tried and tried and never really was able to progress past a certain point, which runs so counter to not only how we think of a redemption narrative in the States, but how we think of people's lives, that if you try hard enough, if you want it hard enough, if you hope hard enough, you will be able to heal yourself, and that's simply not true. From a literary perspective, I also wanted to know, what would the tension be? What would the momentum be? What would the thrust be? After a certain point, I think the reader realizes, probably around the same time Jude does, that he's not going to get better. And yet, I hope that the reader is invested enough in this point that she keeps reading, that she keeps following, just as he keeps living and keeps trying.
Were you worried that people would think, well, you know where this is going?
No.
Just like people in normal life, when you're dealing with someone who is just not getting better, there is a point where you give up and just step back.
Yes, but I think that we're so conditioned to expect forward movement from people, that even though I think the reader on some level realizes that there's only one ending for Jude, we're so taught, we're so instructed to hope otherwise, that I think in a way our cultural conditioning makes us keep reading.
Keeping our hopes up.
Yeah. And then the other germ of this book was different images that I've been collecting for a long time. And I don't know how many of you are writers, and I'm sure you're all exceptions to this rule, but writers tend to know very little about visual art. There's a real lack of engagement with other mediums, and versus visual artists who do consume culture in a much broader way, much more consistently. This is at least in America. There were all of these images that I had.
Can you describe the images?
Yes, one of them was, one of the most important was an early work by Deanne Arbus, called The Backwards Man in His Hotel Room. And it's of a man standing beneath a bare bulb. It's one of her early works, so it's a vertical. And you look at him, you realize there's something wrong, and then you realize that he's wearing his clothes backwards. And then you look again, and you realize that his feet are pointing one way, and his head is pointing another. He's probably a contortionist. But it seemed at the time that I saw it, in probably 2006 or 7, such a perfect picture, a perfect illustration of loneliness, and of someone who was literally at odds with his body. And I remember looking at that photograph and thinking that I would write text for that photograph someday. And it wasn't until many years later that I realized that I did have a story for that photo, and that this was the story.
And visual arts plays a significant part in the book.
It does, it does. And it is probably the one thing that grounds the book in a specific era.
Because
to me, at least.
Okay, because my guess is it's late 90s, early 21st century. Because it's kind of strange that it's almost timeless, the book.
Yes.
In that sense, it's a fairy tale. Mm. Like,
it is supposed to be very much a fairy tale. And it was a conscious mashup of a number of different genres, most prominently a fairy tale, and many of its conventions and tropes are borrowed from the fairy tale. You know, there's a foundling child who has no parents, who suffers great horrors, and there's a rather hollow ending. And then there's the contemporary naturalistic novel. You know, how the characters are educated, how they speak to one another, the sorts of ambitions they have, are all of the stuff from a recognizable, you know, 20th, 21st century book. And then there's a thriller-like aspect to the book, a suspense story. And the book, I hope, does unfold like a thriller does, like a cinematic thriller, that you know that something is lurking in the attic, and except the attic this time is the subconscious, and you have to figure out what it is. And so they're uneasy pairings of genres, I think, and I hope that's what gives the novel its sense of strangeness, and also its sense of its unpinability, if that's a word, but its sense of not being able to be categorized. So it feels like something familiar, but then it's not quite.
And you cataloged some of the images you were inspired by on a Pinterest page?
I did.
And,
yes.
And the description of the Pinterest page is quite interesting, I think. Because you said these artists, you described them as artists who use their medium not just to tell stories, but to do psychological plunder.
Oh, did I say that?
Which is a wonderful word, plunder, because it sounds exactly like what it is.
Right, right. I mean, what you really realize when you look at art, at visual art, is that it does ask the same fundamental question as fiction does. You know, what is it to be human? What is it to be alive? But it does so in a language without words. It does so in an unrecognizable form.
But the word plunder suggests a moral aspect. And it's almost a reprimand.
It is, but you know, I want to back up and say that most of the artists were American artists, and the American artist, whether in fiction or in art, is very interested in the psychology and the self. And in that way, I also think this is a particularly American book, and so the two informed each other.
Mm-hmm. Although the success proves that it's not a particularly American book.
Well, I don't know necessarily. No, I mean, I think that American psychology and our certainty that we have answers to life is of extreme interest to the rest of the world, and you know, not you
you're
know.
Just, you're riding the wave of soft power.
Yes, I'm riding the wave of soft power. I hadn't thought about that. That's the line from the back of the book.
So, your debut novel with People in the Trees was based on the story of Daniel Gajducek, who was a Nobel laureate,
yes,
turned abuser. He was disgraced, and he was some way. Your family knew him. What was the story behind that?
Yeah. Well, the character in the first book, the protagonist in the first book, is based on the scientist named Daniel Carlton Gajducek, who was one of the great scientists of the 20th century, and he spent much of the early 1950s in Papua New Guinea, working with a tribe called the Fore, who were a Stone Age tribe who had contracted a disease, and they would shake, called kuru, the shaking. They would shake and shake, and they would die. And what Gajducek discovered was that they were infected with something called a slow-acting prion, which is a kind of virus, scrapie, mad cow, Creutzfeldt Jakob, they're all the same family, that can incubate in the body for years, and then it suddenly triggers and it kills you. And so he became, you know, he was trained as a pediatrician, and he became a leading medical anthropologist and immunologist. He had labs at the National Institute of Health. He was a great scientist. He couldn't work in any of those fields or in virology in throughout the late 20th century and not know him. But unfortunately, his legacy has become, at least in some circles, based upon something that happened later in his life. In 1999, it was announced that he had been the subject of an FBI sting and that he had sexually abused several of his adopted children. He had adopted 50 children from Papua New Guinea and lived with them in this big house. And he was sentenced to prison. He spent, I think, 18 months. And afterwards, he went to Norway and spent the rest of his time there. Mm-hmm. And he, both my uncle and my father were medical researchers. And he was a great hero in our household. And someone who was admired for the brilliance of his mind and for his wit and for his creativity and for the sort of...
You say in your household, so he was also kind of a hero to you.
Well, I was very young, but I remember meeting him once, and he was just one of those kind of great men of science that you don't really get to see anymore. But, of course, one of the questions that the book asks is, you know, can we really make a separation between a great mind or a great man and someone who does repellent things? Mm-hmm. And also, I wanted to talk about, I think of it as a book about colonialism and about what happens to an island, Hawaii in my case, where I grew up, when it's discovered and the inevitable decline that it experiences.
So we have, on the one hand, your debut novel is basically about a perpetrator, and and the little life is about the victim. Mm. Are they linked directly in that way, or is that?
I didn't see the second as an answer to the first. I think they're companions, but this is actually not my observation. I stole it from someone else. But I think one of the things that the two share is an interest in how the body decays and how the body falls apart, and also this idea of trauma being something that, like a prion, can live inside a person for decades, and then suddenly, you don't know when, but you know it will happen. Something will happen, and then that trauma starts infecting the entire body.
How did you arrive at the fairy tale-like quality of the book, that the world that almost exists outside of time? There are hardly any women in the book at all, and that everybody's, as I said, ridiculously successful. So that's a decision you make. Mm. I'm going to make them very successful. What was the thought process?
Well, I'll start with the success. It is a book about New York. It's not about the landmarks of New York or the history of New York, but it's about the psychology of New York. It's about what brings people there. It's about the shared ambition people have. It's about the competitiveness. It's about how people in New York arrange, categorize lives. Is it a big life? Is it a small life? And because it's a city that fetishizes success so much, because it's a city where your past doesn't matter, where the only thing that matters is who you are that day and who you might become the next day, there is a real, many people there have a real collector's mentality when it comes to people in their lives. And I've been to dinner parties when you actually go around the table and people say what they do, where the host introduces you by your credentials. And it's not merely that success loves success, although I think that's true. It's also, I think, a New Yorker's way of reminding herself that I'm never going back to where I was. I've made it, and I need to keep reminding myself again and again and again. Mm-hmm. And the currency there is not love, it's not that it's not love, but it's measuring who you are and how far you've
come. But it's also the illusion of success. There's this mm-hmm. great joke in Serpico, and I stole this joke from Charlie Kaufman, by the way.
There's a lot of borrowing here.
Better well stolen.
Yeah.
And the story goes, so there's the scene in Serpico. Serpico is a film with Al Pacino. Al Pacino is a cop, but his girlfriend is a wannabe actress, I think. And
yeah,
they go to this party, and everybody is, and he says, "Well, what do you do?" And everybody's like, "I'm a waiter, but I'm an actress,
right.
And I'm a etc., etc. And then they ask him, and he says, I'm a cop and I work for the police department.
Right. No one in New York is a cop who works for the police department.
No.
They're always a cop who's an aspiring screenwriter. But I do think that in New York, you do have these clusters of very successful people, and they cleave to one another. And it you know, I wanted Jude to have money, not just because I think it's an accurate reflection of what happens to the lucky few who have gone to a good school in New York, but frankly, because it takes away some of his concerns. If, you know, someone once asked me what it would be like if he had been poor, and then the entire novel would be about health insurance. It just would. I mean, this is the money aspect to me. He's a very bifurcated person, and I wanted to, like many things in this book, which are so artificial and so heightened, I wanted to really stretch the difference between who he was at home and who he was at work, what he was able to accomplish and how little that mattered. And so
it shows that despite all the success, all the money, all the options, the trauma is the thing that wants to live.
Yes, that's a very good way of putting it. Having said that, I think success is not incidental to the book. It doesn't suggest that money doesn't make a difference, because of course money does. And he has a much more comfortable life than if he hadn't had any money. But yes, you're absolutely right.
Is it fair to say that the extent of the abuse is also fairy tale-like, but in a Gothic sense?
Well, everything in this book is artificial, and everything is exaggerated. And one of the reasons I chose to combine so many genres is I wanted to have the flexibility of exploding a single genre and have it move into the realms of the surreal. I mean, this book is very formally structured. But it is, I think, tonally experimental, or at least that's how I'd like to think of it, that it does venture into territories that a contemporary naturalistic novel might not. And so everything, from the lack of women, to the lack of time, to the lack of irony, as you might say, to the lack of, history is intentional. And I hope has the effect of making the reader feel like they're in some other world that's not quite their own. You know, when I was creating this New York for the book, one of the books I really looked to was Philip Pullman's The Golden Compass, in which there's an Oxford that's not quite the Oxford we know. It's sort of, it's another Oxford, and the formalities and the ceremony and some of the history and architecture of the original university remain.
It's a parallel.
But it is, and he heightens all of the romance of the institution and gets rid of all the faculty meetings. And in the same way, you know, there is a heightened sense of abstraction, I hope, in this book. And it's, I think, the sort of book where you either surrender to the fact that this is not quite always believable, or you don't. And if you can't or you don't, there's too much that's going to trip you up.
I understood that your editor had some trouble surrendering at times, and you had to fight tooth and nail to keep some stuff in.
Yes, because I thought it was a bad argument. I mean, I've had the argument about violence in this book, and I think there's two arguments, and his argument was the weaker one. His argument was that readers can't take a certain amount of violence, which I think is ridiculous. Readers can take anything.
Well, that's second guessing anyway.
It is, and it's not the writer's job to be a parent, and it's not the reader's job to be condescended to. Any reader who opens a book is beginning with an act of bravery, and that's entering the world. And any writer, her only obligation is to make as complete a world as possible, and that's it. The aesthetic argument about violence, is it becoming pornographic? Is it becoming just something that is in to shock or titillate, is a legitimate question.
I'm coming back to that.
Okay, I won't say anything about that.
Well, you can say something, but I'm
oh no, sure. Don't worry. I don't want to mess up your rhythm.
Please, yeah. Please say something.
Yeah.
So you wrote the book in like an intense period of 18 months, mm-hmm. and then you just live inside the book, which must be harrowing.
It was. I mean, I had a day job, so that made things easier, because you go to the work and all of a sudden, you know, the hours from 10 a.m. to 7 p.m. are spent with people like you asking where their money is and, you know, where their edit is and when their expenses are going to be paid. And it's useful for a writer to have that, especially when the creative, the fictional world feels so intense. And so at the end of the day, I would come back and I would be able to slip back into the waters of this book. And then every morning I would get myself out of it. But it was an experience I didn't realize was so draining until I was well outside of it.
Mm-hmm. Of course, one can't help but wonder in what ways your personal life, and especially your childhood, has informed this book. So you said your father was a doctor,
mm-hmm.
And you, your family was constantly moving.
We moved a lot, and so much of the iconography of the book about the American roadways were things I remember from my childhood. But yes, we moved a lot. We moved 9 times, which isn't that atypical for America. I think people tend to move there quite a bit. But this sense of being able to always remake oneself was something that my parents really believed in. Probably not consciously, but it is the promise of the country.
You said something interesting about Jude in the interview, and I quote, "I wanted Jude to feel to the reader like a self-taught human, someone who had to study and attempt as a young adult the sensations and feelings, trust, love, anger, that are most effectively learned in childhood." And I thought, well, did this go for you as well? Because when you're constantly uprooted and maybe having a hard time sustaining friendships, you're missing something.
That's a good line, a self-taught human. I don't remember saying that, but that's a good line. I'm going to save that for later. It wasn't the same for me. I think that, you know, when you think about a character like Jude, you realize that the necessary skills for adulthood are things that are taught when you're very young. And they're a sort of self-possession. It's about the right to be angry. It's about the right to declare that you have rights as a human. And although, of course, children, very young children, can't necessarily articulate that, they are either raised in an environment where they are allowed to somehow try to communicate that, or they're raised in an environment where they're not allowed that at all. And Jude was never allowed that at all. And if you're not allowed that as a child, it's almost impossible to learn as an adult. So although we moved frequently, I never doubted that there was a foundation for me, that I didn't have rights as a full human, that if I wanted to say what I felt about my position in the world or how I felt, that it wouldn't be listened to.
Mm-hmm.
And those are irreplaceable skills.
So you were well taught.
Yes.
Yeah. Well, I also wondered, because of something that you said in the acknowledgments.
God.
Yeah.
It's horrible. If you say it, it's coming back to you.
This is where it turns into therapy.
Yeah, it should lie down.
So, in the acknowledgement, you say thanks to a lot of people, and you say, "I have long thought Joshi Milo and Evans Moak and Stephen Morrison and Chris Upton role models for how to behave in a loving relationship," which gave me the thought, well, there's still something to learn. You need to learn how to do that.
Well, both of those couples, I admire, because they were always kind to each other. They are always kind to each other. And when you mention irony-peppered works, I made the conscious decision to not be ironic in this book. And I remember when my editor was reading it, he said, "They're so kind to each other." And it's somewhat depressing that we've gotten to a stage in not only fictional culture, but real culture, in which affection can only be tempered with irony, with a sort of jokiness, with sincerity has become a rarity. And I did want to, so many of the people I admire in my life do treat other people in their life with consistent kindness and consistent compassion. And I don't just mean in the way they speak to each other, although I do mean that, but I also mean in their ability to not take easy shots, to not just play things for jokes. And in a very jokey age, it takes a real sense of centeredness and a real sense of integrity to not go for the easiness, to not go for the humor, to not go for the joke. And those two couples in particular are people who never use an opportunity to make sport when they really should be listening, which I think is a lesson that I didn't learn until relatively recently. But some people know. Some people have a genius for kindness, and they have a genius for friendship. And many of the characters in this book have that genius.
So recently, learning this recently, how did it change your life?
Well, it's very hard. I mean, I consider myself most like JB, and he's the character who changes the most in the book, for whom friendship isn't a natural gift. It's something that he has to work on. And unlike Jude, who remains consistent all the way throughout in terms of how he thinks about himself and his place in the world, JB is someone who really has to rethink and to, in a sense, to not let his intelligence and his natural wit rule his decisions and rule his personality. Not that I think that I'm as smart or as witty as JB, but it takes more of a conscious effort for me to be kind than it does for any of my friends. Is that good enough, Doctor?
Let's shut you up.
I think therapy's over. You're healed.
Thank you so much.
I was very interested in the role motel life plays in the book, and I read a little bit about motels being a big part of your life, again, probably because of all the movie. And personally, I really like the American, I just like the road, and also motel life, because it's an in-between world where the safeguards of social cohesion dissolve, and there's great freedom, but there's also grave danger.
Yes, completely. I mean, it's no accident that so many great American movies, that so many great American photos are set in motels. I mean, America is a transient country and a young country. And there is the sense, depressingly and often euphorically, that everyone is on the move somewhere, that pasts are constantly being rewritten, that there's always a sense of escape, that the country is always big enough to hide in. And I remember when I was sitting in those motel rooms as we drove back and forth across country during various moves, this sort of unsettling sense, this sort of stomach-plunging sense, although I wouldn't have been able to articulate it as a child, that there were many lives being lived around me that I would never know and would always be mysterious to me, and yet they were so close. They were on the other side of the wall. They were, you know, outside in the parking lot. And there is something horrific about that.
Did you fantasize about those lives?
No, it was just unnerving enough to know that they were there. And that's often how it feels in a country that large. You are always struck by the unknowability of your citizens and of the country at large, and of the sense that that encounters there are so impermanent and so fleeting. And again, this wasn't something I would have been able to articulate, but as an adult, you realize that there's something so mournful and something so chilling about motel lives, and about it's almost a chance to connect with another human, but not quite. And there's something unsettling about that. Mm-hmm.
So what happens to Jude in the motel rooms is just horrific. And his case, in general, is very extreme. Would you say that, well, to me it was relatable, but on a completely different scale. Mm-hmm. Do you think that the success of the book lies partly in the fact that these dynamics of abuse, of dealing with people who have issues with abuse are way more universal than you think?
I think, and this is just from people who have been kind enough to write me, that part of the connection people feel to Jude and to the story is that it's an honest book. And that it also sees Jude for his whole life, for the ugly parts of it, for the irreparable parts of it, for the shameful parts of it, and declares him a full man anyway. Mm-hmm. And I think that, you know, for many of us, what a book does is, a fictional work does, and what I hope for this book as well, is it answers something that we didn't know we wanted to ask. That it says something to us that we didn't know that we felt. And in Jude's suffering, and I hope in the matter-of-fact way that his suffering is addressed and depicted, there is a sense that there's very little to be ashamed of, that the body is the body, and the self, no matter what has happened to it, is still the self and irreducible. And I wonder if that's part of the response to Jude himself, to his life as depicted in this book.
So you said that a lot of people wrote you, of course they did, and so you got a lot of reactions. What stood out?
There is, and this letter came fairly recently, so I've been thinking about it a lot, but it was from a social worker in the UK who said that she had a young client, a man, in his, it sounded like his early 20s, who had had a life very similar to Jude's, and experienced many of the same things. And she said she was certain he would kill himself. And the book brought her peace, mm-hmm. if that happens.
And so how do you react to that? As a, maybe not even by writing back, but just as a person?
Well, I think people who make it their life's work to help people who refuse help are truly admirable. It's very, very difficult for them to do, and especially when it's someone who doesn't want to be helped or doesn't know how to accept help. But I think that the book also says that there's nothing shameful in dying, and there's nothing shameful in not wanting to live. You know, we tend to talk about people who die or who kill themselves in terms of cowardice. We use sports metaphors, you know, he lost his battle, he gave up. We tend to use words like coward. And, you know, for many people, and for all of us ultimately, what we choose to do with their life is the last act of agency we have, and so for some people, the only act of agency they have. And it's, I think for as generous as we pride ourselves as being, and as helpful as we pride ourselves as being, we have very provincial and narrow ideas about how long a person should keep living, and whether a person should choose life. And life is not always the answer to life for everyone.
Mm-hmm. I'm not sure how I'm going to broach this. This is not a question, it's more kind of a story. I have a friend, a woman friend, and she has some serious issues with self-harm.
Mm-hmm.
And I spoke to her about the book, asked her if she read it. And she told me that she was afraid of the book, mm-hmm. and put off reading it for a long time.
Mm-hmm.
But then she did, and it had kind of like she had a dual response to it. On the one hand, she felt seen and understood in a way, but she also said that she almost felt summoned by the book to hurt herself,
mm-hmm.
to show solidarity with Duke.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought, well, I never thought about a book being able to do that, and I thought, geez, that's... Is there a moral obligation for writers to even consider that kind of reaction at all?
It's a wonderful question. I don't know. I don't know. I don't know. We do talk about the artist and the person as two separate mm-hmm. beings, and that's often we do so because the artist gets to get away with bad behavior and in the name of art. But I don't know the answer other than I'm sorry for that.
Yeah. Well, I'm sorry for my friend too. But it's something that just got me thinking because I'm a writer.
Mm. What do you think?
Too cerebral way to look at it.
No, I think, you know, I mean, there's, you know, people ask me if I wrote the book to help people and whether I'm happy if it does. And I don't think you write fiction or create anything in order to help people. Sometimes it very happily does. But I think that there's something so arrogant in thinking that I'm going to write something, it's going to speak to someone, it's going to make them feel this way. As if what you think of as feeling better or as a solution is anyone else's idea of a solution. So I'm honored that if it does help somebody, however they interpret help, but it's, instead of being collateral damage, it's a collateral benefit, I guess.
Mm-hmm. I think I agree, yeah. Mm-hmm. Talking about the different kinds of reactions, you don't read
it? I don't. So it makes life very easy, actually.
But you hear about it.
Very rarely, actually. People know not to tell me, and so I guess...
Who are those people?
Yeah. Well, you. I sense you. You're going to be one. But no, I don't read reviews. So, you know, I normally... the reactions I hear from great readers who are generous enough to write me, but most of them are very kind, although sometimes you get people saying things like, you know, I got something and it said something like, I really didn't like the food that you cooked on page, you know. So, how did you come up with that recipe? I'm not a cook, so it's another imagery.
I wrote a book about the way I grew up, and I grew up with quite an unhinged mother. Mm. And I gave her the book to read before it got published, to say, is there anything there? And the book is not great for her. And then she said, well, the car on page 205, that wasn't a Mazda 636, it was a FN87. You're missing the point.
Thank God she got that.
But there was this kind of literary brawl that ensued. You probably heard about this. Daniel Mendelsohn wrote a piece for the New York Review of Books.
I did hear about that, and the funny thing is, I was his publicist when his book came out, which I take it he didn't mention in the review. But yes, I was his publicist.
So he kind of claimed that you cheated your readers by manipulating with overblown abuse. Mm-hmm. But then people came to the rescue, and other writers attacked Mendelsohn for misogyny. But you just stand back then?
Well, I didn't know about this, that there was a brawl, actually. I knew that there was a review, and I heard it was by him, and I thought it was bizarre and shitty that he didn't mention I was his publicist. But I haven't read it, and I didn't know there was a brawl. It's so exciting. You know, over little old me, you know, that people try
to... How was his book that you were the publicist for?
It's wonderful. It's called The Elusive Embrace. And it's about a history of male homosexuality in Greek culture. But I haven't read the review, so, and I didn't know about the brawl.
Well, I'm going to say something else about a review, a Dutch review. Well,
okay.
It's going to get worse.
Yeah, go for it.
Well, maybe to introduce that, I kind of want to make a point. I do feel that people who deal with literature on a professional level have more fixed ideas about what literature is and should be. Mm. And they get some kind of brain freeze when a book doesn't conform. And in Holland there's a very well known and also a very good young writer called Joost de Vries. Mm. And he kind of... He wrote a critical piece saying that it was pain porn, basically. Mm. But then, almost as an afterthought, he admitted that it made him cry. Mm-hmm. And that made me think of, there was, I think maybe a month or two ago, there was a review in one of our big newspapers of the science fiction classic, A Man in High Castle by Philip K. Dick. Mm. And that reviewer said, basically, I think science fiction is an inferior genre, but I like this book, so it can't be science fiction.
Right.
Instead of acknowledging that your own ideas may be fiction.
Right, right. I mean, I think and this is something that I have to work on as a reader myself, it's so easy to say that this is what the novel should be, this is what a novel is, instead of accepting a novel at face value. And it's particularly difficult when a book, I think, as this book consciously does, work against the current American literary trends. As you mentioned, it's not ironized. It's extravagant. It's excessive. It's operatic. It's melodramatic. I didn't go to a writing program, so I didn't know the rules I was supposed to break and not supposed to break. And I feel that it very much reads like a book by an autodidact writer, someone who has taught herself as she went along. And, I think that, I agree, I think there's a certain critical establishment that wants a book to live within a recognizable literary trend or landscape. And all of us who are readers are guilty of that to some extent. And I think you're right that it's very difficult if you're cool and cerebral, and I mean cool in both senses, to talk about a book's emotionality, to talk about it in terms of not with the head but with the heart. It feels like you're discussing a lesser work. It feels like you're discussing something that is meant to be a mass fiction, because literary fiction traditionally, or at least not for many years, has ventured into that territory.
So the book is full of men. Well, there's a couple of women.
There's a couple.
Let's not knock the women. So what fascinates you about men, and especially gay men?
Well, I don't know if it's especially gay men, but it's about, as a novelist, it's always interesting to work with a tribe or a group of people who are limited in some way by society, or by the state, or by another person. And what happens when that person or that group of people pushes up against the boundaries of what they can or can't do? In this case, what happens to when men who are traditionally not taught to express certain kinds of emotions, or to talk about emotions at all, or to talk about shame and shame of the body, what happens when they have those feelings and haven't been given permission to give language to them? How does that come out? How do those very real emotions work their way out of the body and out of the mind? And so much of this book is the character saying again and again, I can't speak, I can't speak. And it's fascinating to work with characters who don't have language. They literally don't have language to say what they need to say, what the body is telling them to say. And so someone once asked me what this book would be like if it was all women, and it would probably be a third of the length. Because so much of the tension of the book is, how will they learn how to say what nature, which nurture has never taught them to say?
Mm-hmm. And it's also, they are also men that lack, let's say, the normal family life, and their friendship is kind of an alternative family. Mm.
Yes, and it is. My publicist, I was in Spain last month, and the interviewers there kept asking me what it felt like to live a Peter Pan lifestyle, because I'm not married and I don't have kids. But, the reality is, for many people at this point in human history, and especially in large cities, the idea that there's only one way to have a family, and that that family should be blood, and that there's only one way to have a romance, and that romance should be with one other person, or that there's only one way to be an adult, and that adulthood includes a commitment to another person and maybe taking care of offspring, is ludicrous. I mean, if that's all of human, if this is where we are in human history, and this is as far as we've gotten, then, we're going to run out of options pretty soon. There has to be other ways of living an adult life, and for many of us, there already are.
Are you working on something new?
No.
Because it's been a while since you...
It has been a while, but I need to get another job. I mean, talking about health insurance, I need to go back to America and find a job.
A lot of money.
No.
No?
Health insurance is $1,000 a month. Yeah. Look how there's dead silence. But it is, I need to get a job when I get
back. That's shocking.
Unless you're offering.
To pay your health insurance?
Yeah.
No, the writing at home doesn't pay that well, so I guess I cannot go for it.
Yeah, well, thank you.
So, well, then I cannot ask what the future holds, but not in terms of a book. Do you have an idea? Do you want to work on a book? Do you have an idea?
Yes, I do. And I'm interested in writing about the end of the West.
Just take a tiny
yeah, right.
Yeah, about a micro theme.
So it's going to be a big book. Are you going to write about the end of the West in another book?
It's going to be a comedy. I don't particularly want to write a big book, but like most people who write long books, I'm fairly self-indulgent. A novel allows you to be self-indulgent, but I hope it won't be a long book.
But would you say that you actually need a job to be able to write?
I need the discipline of the hours. I need a structure, and you know, any of you who are writers, it's such lonely work that it's very helpful to be around other humans and to just be reminded daily of how they speak and how they move and how they think. Just the rhythms of being around humans, I think, is helpful.
I want to open it up to the public as well. There should be a microphone. Okay, well, so we're going to put it over there. There's probably a lot of people who have a question. There are, otherwise you'll get a spanking. Who's the first hero to walk up to that dangerous thing over there? There we go. It's like dancing. You need one, and then...
Yeah, that's true. That's true.
Right. I'll be the first dancer. Yeah. I was wondering, you said you don't read reviews, so I'm not sure how much of this you got. Mm-hmm. Last year you were shortlisted for my Booker Prize, mm-hmm. and actually most of the newspapers predicted you to win, mm-hmm. but you didn't. Mm-hmm. I was crossed for it, and I don't mm-hmm. know how you felt. But
thank you.
I was wondering if you got any of that sort of the media circus going around the Booker Prize and how that was for you.
Well, the event itself is, thank you for your nice words, the event itself is horrible. So it's like basically Ugly Miss America. So, you know, there's six authors, and everyone's a varying degree of socially inept, and you go into the green room. There's a series of events leading up to the awards. And you go into the green room, and everyone's standing in different corners, staring at each other. There's one author, I'm not going to say who literally turned around and stared at he was in a corner. And he turned around and just stared at the corner until one of his publicists had to come gently lead him away. And you do a series of events. It wasn't Ann Tyler, who was the person I was the giddiest to meet. And you do a series of events, and you know, automatically a cool kids group separates itself. And you run into them and they pretend not to know who you are, even though there's only two women and there's only five other people. And you go to the event, and there's cameras rolling around, and people at your table from your publishing house are kind of placing bets, and there's rumors that start breaking midway through the ceremony, and they're all looking at you, and you know how much money they stand to make if you win. And then, so the cameras are roaming around, and they're waiting to see who's going to be called, and then Marlon James' name is called, and everyone at your table looks down at your plate is unable to make eye contact. And then you get up, and you go back in your car, and you eat a lot of french fries, and then you go to bed. And the next day, you catch the flight, and you go straight back into the office, where all of your colleagues say, "We were watching it on TV, but no one else in the building cares." And then you're there till midnight closing the issue. So that's how it was for me. I can't say how it was for anyone else. But, you know, in America, the Booker doesn't really... It made a difference for me because it was the award that I really watched when I was growing up, and it was hugely meaningful, and I was so thrilled. But Americans don't follow it as much. They do a little more now that Americans are actually involved. But it's a big deal in the UK and a much bigger reading culture there in general. So it's thrilling to be there, but it's you're so anxious you kind of can't make sense of it. Thank you.
Well, a second ago someone else was standing up.
Thank you.
taking all my nerve. I've never done this before, so if I feel nervous, but I loved your book.
Oh, thank you so much.
It meant a lot to me.
Thank you.
And hearing you talk about it and the questions that you've been asking, I don't think when I was reading it, I thought, oh, this is like a fantasy or a fairy tale, or I just got really involved in the characters and their lives. But I think I did know, like you were saying, that by the end, Jude's gonna die. But why did William have to, you know, be taken out? Everything that he went through. But that like took me, I was like, no, you know, it was like that.
Yeah.
You're going to get flagged from that one.
No, there's a lot of accusations of sadism. But I do think that Jude's life would have, his story would have ended the same regardless. And I think that, you know, I knew the ending of the story before I started writing it. And which is always what I do for whatever I write, whether it's a short article or a book. And then your path is just, there's many different ways to get to the end, but you know what your final destination is. But I wanted it to end with a picture of complete loneliness. So it went away, it ends how it begins.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. I suspect that's not a very satisfying answer. Thank you.
Thank you for the compelling experience. But I was wondering, could you please elaborate on the way you develop your perspectives or your focalizations? Because some parts I told were with Jude, and then were with Willem, and there was also the telling of Harold's.
Right.
How did that develop?
I knew that I wanted to create a sort of what I called a warm third-person omniscience. And so in Jude's parts, you're right, it's the only part in which he's never named. When the attention switches to him, he's only called he. His name is never actually said. For the other characters, their names appear occasionally. But you never really get outside of, know what they think beyond what they're thinking in terms, when it comes to Jude, in relation to Jude. And so I decided to have three parts in which the book would break into first person, into Harold's voice. And the breaks come after three particularly difficult parts of Jude's life. And Jude is meant to be a reliable and a trustworthy narrator, but the reader also knows early on that he's not to be trusted about himself. Not because he's lying, but because his ideas about himself are so warped. And so Harold enters when it is possible for the reader to find himself at the very bottom of the funnel of Jude's thinking about himself. And Harold offers a different perspective, one that's not colored or shadowed by Jude's voice. And I thought it was necessary to have that sort of jolt out of Jude's soundscape, as it were.
And did you just consider not to do that, or to do it in another way?
It was something that my editor and I talked about a lot because it is very false, and he said it seemed too novel-y, you know, to have that break. But it's a book of so many constructions and of such falsity in so many ways that I also felt that it knocked a little bit more shape into a structure that I think more rigorous could have become a little too numbing. Thank you.
I also want to thank you for your book.
Thank you.
I work as a physician in child protection. It's been very inspiring to me too. My question is on self-harm. Mm-hmm. I have also a question on self-harm. One of the things in the book that was a bit difficult for me to get to understand was the amount and the degree of self-harm of the Jude, and the fact that he remains a functioning lawyer, even if he functions very well. I think in reality you say everything is exaggerated and excessive, but well, this is very unreal to me. So I just wonder, is there a person that you know that resembles a bit Jude, or any questions on this?
I think that, you know, the cutting for Jude is an addiction, and like many addictions, it is the person saying that I have the right to control my body at last, even if it means destroying it. And while I don't know anyone who is a self-harmer, I do know people who have had severe addictions and have been able to function brilliantly. And then in their after hours, what they consider their private hours, their true self, they put their body through terrible torments. And it was important for me to show the day-to-day, the daily reality of Jude's life, that it was a brutal life, a violent life, that whenever the reader thinks, well, he might be getting better, he might have all this, he might have a job, you're reminded again and again, this is how this life is being lived. It's being lived terribly, it's being lived punishingly. That although we can look the other way when it comes to people in their lives, if you're involved in the life of this character in this book, you can't look away. You are forced to reckon with a very, very difficult and very brutal and very violent life.
Right. But still, I wonder if you had any readers who have been questioning you about this. If you say you haven't had very many
people. I haven't. And in fact, it's been the opposite of people saying, you know, I know someone who harms himself like Jude, or I have harmed myself like Jude, which is, of course, awful to hear. Thank you.
Just a quick question. How much time do we have left?
10 minutes.
10 minutes? Okay.
Hi. I absolutely love the book.
Oh, thank you.
I was especially thrilled to see representation of disabled people in here as well. And I was wondering, how do you feel any apprehension sort of inhibiting the identity of a person that you can only mentally empathize with and not have the actual experience of disability, self-harm, homosexuality? Do you feel any apprehension, sort of, I suppose appropriating would be a value judgment, but representing these sort of minority viewpoints and identities?
You know, that's a great question, and of course it's one that's been actively discussed, especially with Lionel Shriver's recent speech at Brisbane. You know, I mean, I sort of invented, after the fact, a few rules for writing across difference, as we say. I mean, first of all, I think a writer can and should be able to write about anyone, all sorts of lives, not just the lives that they inhabit. Second, you know, I think, you know, difference, you're right, comes in many, many different forms. There's racial difference, there's gender difference, there's sexuality difference, there's ability, there's difference of ability. And you always have to be careful that the character who is different from you is not just a symbol. You better know everything about them. If all you can see is, if all you know is the fact of their difference, then you haven't created a character. You've created a cardboard figure. And you know, then you also have to understand that I think so much of the anger about writers writing across difference is that the fact remains that relatively few people get to speak, and many people who feel upset about being depicted are so because they don't have the chance to publish, because they're not being able to be authors of their own story. And that's something that a writer has to be sensitive to. And the last is that if you do write a character who's different, then you have to be prepared for people who represent that group to really be upset and to really hate it. And there's nothing you can do. If that happens, then...
But did it happen?
Not to my face, but I think...
Through your mailbox, maybe?
Not yet. Not yet, but I think that your character, and this sounds so goofy and simplistic, your character is a person, and your character will be different from you, let's hope, in many ways, but your character is also going to be similar to you in many ways, and you owe the character the full dignity of making them a full person. So I hope that, again, that when people read this book, they see that I see Jude as a full human, that he may not see himself that way, but his friends do, and I do. And I think a reader can always tell when the writer sees the full person and when the writer doesn't.
Yeah, I could really tell. Thank you.
Thank you.
thank you for taking the time to talk with us.
Thank you.
I had a question. How I came across this book was a little different, actually. I actually bought this last minute to go on a holiday to read by myself, which was an interesting experience.
Right.
I had no idea what I was getting myself into, but I had a question about the dynamic, the group dynamic between the friends. Mm-hmm. I found the character of JD really interesting because he was such an enabler in the group. He was mm-hmm. very active, whereas you had more passive roles from the other friends in a sense. And he always had one step in the group, one step out. Mm-hmm. And by that, he kind of felt like a meta character mm-hmm. where he was constantly kind of thinking about the strangeness and uniqueness of the friendship group. Mm-hmm. Was in the third act of the book, he kind of disappears or takes a backstage or so to fully develop the relationship between mm-hmm. Jude and Willem. And I was wondering what the reason was behind that choice for that character.
Well, I mean, I loved writing JB, and he's someone who I think is, well, I'll say a couple things. I mean, I think, first of all, that I wanted the book to feel the way that long-term friendships often feel, that Malcolm, for example, is someone who's central to their lives but recedes in daily importance, and yet his decency keeps him in the circuit of friends. JB, I wanted to create someone who had always been able to get by on his smarts and his wit and less on his compassion. And there is a point when, and it comes for those of us, again, who are less gifted at friendship, at different points of our adulthood, when one really starts to wonder how one wants to be as a person, and who one wants to be as a person. And specifically in New York, a city perhaps that values intelligence and again fetishizes it, whether intelligence is enough, whether it's enough for a whole life, and whether it's enough to propel one forward. And so it is, I did want JB to be somebody who really was forced to think about what it meant to be ethical, what it meant to be compassionate, and what it meant to be kind, and what it meant to have a meaningful life. And it comes to him slowly and with great difficulty.
Thanks a lot.
Thank you.
Okay, last one, I think.
Thank you very much for a great book. I think one of the mechanisms with which you relate to your readers mm-hmm. is you psychologically dissect a lot of emotions and a lot of dilemmas and things we confront in difficulties in life. So on the one hand, you have these minority groups or whatever who struggle. On the other hand, you have this theme of success. And these four friends are extremely successful. It's mm-hmm. off the chart. Mm-hmm. So they're all one in a thousand sort of type mm-hmm. of persons. Do you need that? Or could you have risen to the challenge of writing it in just normal lives, like normal people who struggle with all these problems and don't have comfort? What is it? Is that the New York scene or something you need to relate to the emotions with success which we have? Or why can't it just be normal people?
Well, I do think that it is representational of a certain kind of fantasy New York. And I did want to create a heightened New York where there was money and there was there were people who were ambitious and people who actually made it, however you want to define that. And in a way, their great success, as I said, it's not incidental, but what's foregrounded is a different kind of struggle. So it's not the struggles that you find in many American novels these days about the difficulties of day-to-day life. And not that I think they're not important, but I wanted this book to be about the different kinds, about psychic struggles, about emotional struggles, about traumatic struggles. And I wanted it to play out against a very glittery background. So I wanted there to be sharp contrasts, and there are in all senses of the book. You know, the contrast between great success and great trauma, or between the contrast between, you know, the implication of women, but there's no actual presence. The extremes of, you know, great horror and great love. So whenever I had a chance to really to juxtapose two great extremes against each other, I tried to go for that. This was a stylistic choice, which is a good catch-all answer.
I want to thank you so much.
Thank you so much. Thank you very much to everyone.